Hey, man, crap has really hit the fan. I'm glad you're here with me, but your loadout looks like it could use a little work, you know? I think you went full budget, yeah? Yeah, that's probably why you're on the ground. That's all right, man. That's okay. Just stay calm. And you know what? Maybe let this be a learning moment for you, all right? With that, maybe we could talk about my preferred crap has hit the fan setup. Yeah, let's do that. Welcome back, everybody. Clint today with Classic Firearms, here to talk about that crap has hit the fan scenario again, because recently we did a video all about myself, Jason, Aaron's, Kaya's SHTF setups. And well, when I was back at the warehouse, I didn't have some of my preferred firearms there, but I did have something ultimately that I would take with me, and that is the M4, the 14 and a half inch M4 with the ACOG. And I'm here to pretty much go ahead and shock everybody with talking about why it isn't my dearly beloved Mark 18. Now, don't get me wrong, I love this rifle. This is a rifle, by the way, you know, all right. And which paying an additional $200 because of the National Firearms Act is absolutely ridiculous, and you shouldn't have to. All gun laws are infringements, so make sure you support organizations that support that mindset, like Gun Owners of America. Okay, now with that being said, the Mark 18, you guys know I have such a profound love for it, but let's be real, it's not the end all be all, okay? If the crap has hit the fan scenario has taken place and I'm probably in my vehicle, then yeah, this is probably the gun that I'm gonna grab because this is my ride or die. But if I truly had, let's say, the ideal situation, I could take whatever I want, depending on what that situation might be, it will be the M4. Specifically, still in the Daniel Defense wheelhouse, the DDM4A1R3 in this type of configuration. And let's go ahead and start at the muzzle and work our way down here. tip the butt, as Aaron likes. And let's start with this right here, the silencer. This is the Huxworks Flow 556K with the Liberty's Defense suppressor cover. Because one thing you'll notice really quick is signature for a silencer is both flash, both sound, but also thermal. And granted, there's everything else on this gun that might give me away, but heat definitely will resonate from the silencer. And you'll notice that, especially in magnified optics, like what I have on here, my Military Overrun or Surplus ACOG that I picked up years ago, you'll notice that that mirage can really obscure and really have a negative effect on your visibility when looking through a magnified optic. So being able to cut that down with something that actually has like meteorite intertwined in here with this cover is good to go, right? So this thing has a very high heat tolerance. In fact, I'm probably gonna stress test this one and see how many rounds I can put through it. Before I burn it off or something, I don't know. Maybe one day, we'll see. But I really like having the silencer covered. This is 14 and a half inch pinned and weld, because again, those NFA laws that I mentioned before are stupid, but they do exist. Now with that, this is also a mid-length gas system. It's not your typical carbine length system that you find in the M4, which is why I definitely like this a lot more, because that allows those gases to travel a little bit further before they start to come back into the system. And it's overall a little bit more enjoyable to shoot that way, because you're not getting so much gas back into the system, which is also right back into your face. And on top of that, it is a little bit softer recoil as well, so it really does feel good to the shooter. You're also going to notice, yeah, I've got iron sights and also a light. So let's go ahead and talk about the iron sights before we roll into the light really quick, because some of you have probably already noticed with my ACOG setup the positioning of my rear sight. It's not ideal, but I'm going to go ahead and tell you right now, I have them on there, even though with the ACOG, some could argue, well, it is the most battle-proven optic in the world, and so it'd be easy to argue that iron sights aren't necessary with this setup. But I'm also, as much as I am confident in the ACOG's abilities, I'm also very confident in my abilities to break an object like an ACOG. And therefore, having something as a backup, and again, the Embus Pros are by Magpul, some of my favorite iron sights, that is what I'm going to throw on mine. Easy enough to pop on and off, or I should say flip up and on. You know what I'm trying to say. What's easy enough to pop on and off is the LaRue mount, the United States Marine Corps, actually LaRue mount for the ACOG. Pull back, rotate out, and now the ACOG is off, and I can get my iron sights locked, loaded, and ready to go. Are they in a preferred location? Sight radius is short. I could have this all the way back here and then have the ACOG, but I don't want to compromise my primary optic, put it that way. My primary sight, I don't want to hinder in any type of way. I want that to be good to go for me, comfortable, ergonomic, get a great sight picture every single time I shoulder my rifle. And I'm not gonna ultimately compromise that by putting this in a more, a better position for something I may or may not use. Right? So with that, I like the idea of having backup irons, but with them not being a primary, I'm gonna put them in probably the not most ideal location, but still practical and still usable for the most part, right? So there you have it. Also, just to go ahead and show you guys the RCO mount here, you'll see RCO, Simplify, LaRue makes some awesome stuff, great mounts, and you can tell right there, it's just easy enough. The QD on it is very simple. Again, go ahead and show you guys as I drop the optic right on the stock. I'm not worried about it. It is designed to sit right back here, right over the charging handle. So that way you get that locks into place now, ready to go, and it holds zero every time, which is great. And now you'll notice when I shoulder this, that eye relief is perfect every single time. And some of you might be wondering too, wait a minute now. What about for up close and personal, man? Where's your red dot? As much as I love an offset red dot, at the end of the day, it has a potential of snagging on gear, on body armor, on anything else. And I would probably, as much as I, again, love just doing that 45 degree cant, it's also not completely ambidextrous. However, having a 12 o'clock mount for your RMR or whatever red dot you choose to go with would be preferred in this situation. But quite simply, I'm deciding to go with the ACOG because I am trained with it and I know how to run the ACOG very effectively, even at close range, using, of course, the bend and aiming concept, which I've talked about plenty of times in different videos, which is ultimately shooting with both eyes open. Shooting with both eyes open, your dominant eye will pick up the reticle, your non-dominant eye will pick up the target, your brain communicates both eyes with both eyes, and it overlays the reticle over the target. You pull the trigger, you hit the target. Just shoot with both eyes open. And if you struggle with that, practice. You can even do that dry firing on an object on your wall. Just make sure your gun isn't loaded because that could be a bad day. All right, continuing, we do have the Surefire Turbo Light. Now with this, a 14 and a half inch build, the reason I decided to like this over perhaps the 10.3, better performance out of the 5.56 cartridge, which would be my go-to cartridge. Why? Because first of all, it's available. It's everywhere. I've got plenty of it on hand, and I'm happy to say that I also know the capabilities of the 5.56 cartridge. If you ever see the interview with Kevin Owen and Grand Thumb, he compliments the 5.56 round through personal experience very well, all right? So take that for what you will. Go check that interview out if you haven't. Now with that, I really like the Surefire light because it has that really focused, I mean, you might even be able to, all right, I can see it. I don't know if the camera, I can see from here that it's picking it up. It has a very focused beam, very focused or high candela, which is great for being able to identify a target or whatever, or a threat, or just looking down range at greater distances. So I really like the idea of having a light on this particular setup. Now, granted, I am currently looking for the ideal cover for my light because, again, negligent discharge of white light can give away your position and get a lot of rounds and ordnance and airstrikes on your position really, really fast, which is another reason I like silencers, because even though they don't completely silence the firearm, common misconception, they still disperse the sound and, of course, the flash, so that way you can't as easily identify the exact direction even that gunshot came from. So silencers in that regard are very useful, right? Okay. You'll also notice on my Surefire Turbo light, I have two methods of activating the light. One is a push button right back here, which is easy to get to if I'm in a weird position. I can't get my thumb to the 12 o'clock for the momentary and the constant on of the Surefire pressure pad. You know, it allows me to activate the light. Again, two is one is none type of situation, right? So there you have it. Now, granted, I'm not going to throw two flashlights on here with that type of mindset either, but you know, to each their own. If you want two flashlights on your gun, I guess go for it. All right, coming back a little bit further, a short little vertical grip. This is actually the Daniel Defense vertical grip. It's the one piece of furniture I don't mind from Daniel Defense. It's short, lightweight, takes up only one M-lock space, and I'm not too, you know, it stays where it needs to stay, and it's comfortable enough to grip. I don't broom handle my vertical grips, as I've mentioned on camera plenty of times as well. I typically like to get more of a C-clamp, if not something like this here, right? This allows me to get that thumb over bore to activate the light easily enough, or not, right? I can just go ahead and ride parallel if I want, or I can cross over. It allows me to get to it, however, especially going non-dominant. There you go, same situation. I can get to the light here, I can get to it here. It's easy enough to activate. Awesome, I like that. And you'll also notice I do have the Magpul rail covers, because what's something that happens whenever you shoot your gun, especially a lot, it gets hot. This rail will start to heat up. I love the R3 or the RIS 3 rail, but at the end of the day, you've got a heavier profile. This isn't the government profile barrel. It's actually a heavier profile barrel, 14.5, as I mentioned, that's gonna get hot. And well, when that piece of metal starts to heat up, the metal surrounding that piece of metal is gonna start to heat up, and then whatever is touching that piece of metal is gonna get hot, and that's usually your bare naked hand. So having something to go ahead and get in between there is nice, right? Or if you're just shooting with gloves, you know, you're mostly fine, but that can still also cause issues. Okay, coming back a little bit further, you're gonna notice I've got, with the RIS 3 rail, you've got also different sling mounting attachment points, both right back here towards the rear. You've got one here, and then where I like to run my Tech 10 sling, right back here. I am a fan of the Tech 10 sling. This is one, my buddy Paul, he's ultimately Tech 10, and when he came and, you know, visited, and he showed us the craftsmanship and the, ultimately the thought process that went behind a sling, it was very impressive, and to this day, I run the crap out of it. Now, I have had one issue before, which is actually a designed issue, where I am absolutely yanking on this piece to get it so snug and tight to my body that I actually broke it, right? But if you look at how this is designed, and I'll show it to you guys really quick. There we go. I think that's mostly on camera for you guys. This little cord that holds your adjustment strap in place is designed to break. So if it gets snug or gets snagged on something like that, it's designed ultimately to break. And also they include like a bunch of them with different sizes with your sling, so you can replace it pretty easy. A lot of guys might just do paracord or something like that as well. And it doesn't exactly eliminate the practicality or the usefulness of the sling, because you can still adjust it with just the buckle itself. It's easy enough to do. This just makes it a little bit easier. I've only had that happen to me once, and if you notice, I'll actually go ahead and just feed this through really quick, whichever way might be easiest. All it is this little piece here, and then it comes right out. And that's that little tab. There it is, that locking piece. It locks back in. Super easy to replace, and not a cheap, or sorry, not an expensive part. And like I said, you can still adjust it. So let's say you don't want that extra piece of material flapping around anyway, you can still adjust the sling with just the buckle that it comes with, which is, this one I do believe is titanium. Super strong, super lightweight. Makes me super happy, okay? So like I said, you can still get back here and make that adjustment. So that way it's tight to the body versus loose. And with the swinger mount that connects to the B5 system stock, this allows me to go just like that there. Obviously I missed a grip because I got in the way of myself, but this allows me to go from non-dominant to dominant, dominant to non-dominant. In other words, shooting right to left-handed, whatever it might be. Again, coming right on back and here, ready to rock and roll, right? So easy enough to do. It doesn't get in the way. I like it a lot. Cool. So that's the Tech 10 Tactical Sling, which again, I am a big fan of. And Paul's just an awesome guy. It also can break down to a single point sling utilizing this piece right here. So I can separate from the rail attachment right back here now. A lot easier to actually do when it's slung up on you. And now I've got a single point sling if I so choose to use that. It's completely up to you and whatever the mission might dictate. But ultimately, if I'm gonna go for something, I would probably use this. I mean, I definitely use this as a dedicated two point. Some might, if I'm gonna run a single point, I'll probably run a dedicated single point. But I still have the option if I so choose. There you go. Cool. Now, as I've mentioned before, the R3 by Daniel Defense, the M4A1 R3, and all of their R3 lines is completely ambidextrous. I like to have the ambi bolt release. It's just easier to manipulate this way. It's easier to clear malfunctions, easier to see down the chamber in case you do got something going on or want to maintain, whatever it is. It's just easier to manipulate the bolt release because why? Well, now I can do it all without having to change positioning of my shooting hand, which is pretty nice. Also, having this guy, a ambi mag release, is also something I'm a really big fan of. Again, there are pros and cons to this because as you can tell on mine here, it's all sorts of scratched up and everything. If it wasn't for the raised metal, the raised material around the actual mag release, I could probably have accidentally actuated this at some point in time when it's hitting my belt buckle or whatever else other piece of gear. So ambi controls are great, as long as they're done right too. I know I give a lot of manufacturers a lot of hell about not including ambi controls, especially on guns that are pretty expensive, but the ones that do it and do it right are great. The ones that do it and don't think about that additional material surrounding whatever that control might be so it doesn't get accidentally manipulated, it's a must. So, you know, keep that in mind too. Great. Coming back a little bit further, after doing the video where we tested the gas back into the face, we tested all sorts of different charging handles, I found that, again, went for the ambi controls, I found that the Geissele, what is it called, the supercharging handle, works the best. That is the one that I absolutely prefer on my rifles. Geissele obviously makes great triggers, just does everything right. Most of everything right. The rails can be debated. But at the end of it all, I am definitely a fan of the supercharging handle. B5 system stock, as I already mentioned before, which I'm in love with. And then for the grip, the Driven Arms Co. grip. I love Driven Arms Co. And if I'm actually running, let's say my IR, things like that, and the light, I'm gonna use the dangler, which ultimately uses the mod buttons, has a mod button here, and then off to the side. Love that setup for my night vision setup. Got it. It's awesome. The dangler is sweet, okay? But I will say that their rifle grips, I love the grip angle, love the way, first of all, it looks cool. The texture as far as the stippling is aggressive enough without having to worry about chopping up your hands, cutting up your hands. It feels great. Definitely a big fan of Driven Arms Co. here. And so this, guys, is my preferred shit has hit the fan situation rifle because everything about it, I trust. And I think that's really what it comes down to it. I trust everything on this rifle. All of these products that have been used on this rifle have been proven in one way or another, either by me because I've shot it and run it and abused it and I trust it, like with the sling, and also the sling being utilized in other components of .gov type of stuff, which I'm not allowed to talk about right now, but is really cool. The Surefire weapon lights, yes, right? Huxworks, proven. The Liberty's Defense, proven. Daniel Defense, proven. Especially to be gassy. Trigicon, proven. So all of that I am very confident, and even my magazines that I like, the P mags. I think this is actually one of my issued mags. But at the end of it all, this is my preferred setup. Now, granted, could there be some, some perfections made in some areas, like having the red dot for up close engagements? Yeah, sure. But at the end of it all, The red dot, even a Trijicon RMR. Batteries, things like that you have to rely on. Granted, with the types of batteries that the Surefire light takes, rechargeable, all that, I can keep about another three of those, two in this tube here on the B5 stock. So I have additional batteries to get to as well. So I'm not worried about that. As far as like the 2032s, little watch batteries that a lot of red dots take, of course, they take a long time to die as well, so I'm not too worried about that. But that would just be an extra thing I'd have to keep on my person and not just somewhere staged safely on my rifle, right? So a lot to take into consider. And it depends, again, on that shit hits the fan scenario. If it's somebody kicking in your door, this probably isn't going to be the gun that I grab. If it's Red Dawn and we've got Russians or North Koreans falling from the sky, I'd feel pretty good about this. Or, you know, a Modus. So it really depends on that situation, which tool I'm ultimately going to use. Shit has hit the fan if somebody's gonna be trying to hurt me and my family and we're out in town somewhere. Well, my tool there is gonna be probably my SIG 365, right? So it really comes down to it. Now with that, I want this to be a discussion between you and me and everybody else on the internet about what your preferred shit hits the fan rifle, pistol, carbine, whatever it is. Talk to me about it down below. And of course, make sure you join me Monday nights, typically around 7 p.m. Eastern for my live streams, which you can find on YouTube, Twitch, Twitter, and Rumble, sometimes on Instagram, but that software just doesn't communicate well with Instagram. And Instagram's just a pain in the ass. So there you have it. But yeah, talk to me, join me again Monday nights. In fact, it's Monday when I'm recording and I gotta hop on here in just about another hour and a half. So I'll be talking to quite a few of you tonight. Get subscribed if you're not subscribed, and don't forget to head on over to cfcontest.com to check out all the wonderful things we've got going on over there, because who doesn't like free stuff? You picking up what I'm putting down yet? And typically there's a code word you can find as well, maybe even at the bottom of the screen that you're watching on, where you could type that in somewhere at cfcontest.com to also increase your chances of, you know, getting said free stuff. All right, and just because I still am in love with it and I want to show you guys one more time, there's my Mark 18. Oh, I guess one other thing we could talk about is ammunition, because I've got range ammo in the M4 right now, but my defensive ammo, because that's the politically correct term to use, 77 grain open tip match. Now, you might not be able to see this pick up all that well on camera, but that is open tip 77 grain, very accurate, heavier ammunition, which I like a lot. The performance you get out at distance, the performance you get in even a short-barreled rifle like the Mark 18 is desirable, to say the least. And with that, you'll also notice too, I think we'd probably need to do a test. You'll notice that the performance you get out of a 77 grain open tip match is a lot better than perhaps 55 grain, even though 55 grain is moving at a higher speed. That velocity is ultimately what makes the 5.56 round very effective, but also the inertia, or just that mass of a slightly heavier projectile making impact onto, let's say, a soft target, also has a more desired effect, is what you can call it here. Oh, and just so you guys know, there is a difference between hollow point and open tip. Hollow points are intended to expand, or designed to expand on impact, where open tip is all about the bullet and the surface area, and which is equal around the entire diameter of the bullet, so that way it doesn't yaw and start to do funny things down range at a longer distance. Open tip is pretty much the design of the cartridge when it's being made, or the projectile, I should say, where a hollow point is ultimately designed to expand. Open tip is made for accuracy down range. Just keep that in mind. There is a difference there. All right. Okay. I think I've done enough talking here now. You guys, thank you so much for joining me again Monday night, so you can find me live on all sorts of different platforms. And as always, we appreciate you, your viewership, your business. God bless. And we'll see you next time at Classic Firearms. And yes, I was about to chamber this and just start unloading into my target there before I realized two things. One, that's my expensive ammo. And secondly, I don't have any ears on. So you'll just have to not go with that. You can watch the intro again, because I do some shooting there.